My name is Selfridge, and my business is taking people down these various rivers in Oregon. Our headquarters is in on the Mackenzie River near Eugene, and from there, while we work out all over Oregon, in fact, many of the western states, taking parties down the river. On this trip, I'll be head guide on your trip down the Wild Owyhee. The Owyhee River is one of our wild desert rivers of Oregon. And it's extremely interesting because you're in a very inaccessible canyon and surrounded by the high rim rock deserts of eastern Oregon. The Owyhee got its name from an early day pioneer trip through the area. There were three Hawaiians on the trip, and as they were crossing the river up on the upper river, one of the Hawaiians were drowned. And from Hawaii, the name was shortened to Owyhee. As near as I can tell, that's the story of the naming of the river. This was one of the old stage stops in the early days when the horse and wagons would come through there, would camp on the river, and then go on south to Winnemucca. The location is quite close to Idaho, quite close to Nevada. It's extreme southeastern Oregon, and of course it's in the desert country. Most of these trips are taken by Mackenzie River boats. This is a high-sided plywood boat that's been developed on the Mackenzie. We take them all over the West for the various trips. We take two passengers to the boat, and our load limit is actually about 400 pounds. So we have to have additional boats to take our food and baggage. On this trip down the Owyhee, we'll take an additional big rubber boat, which will take all of our equipment. Of course, we furnish all the food. We furnish life jackets and everything except personal equipment.
Oh, you look great.
Well, I like the Hawaii. No, I know why.
And Fred takes things right out to the crate.
Okay, I need them.
Now that's your word,
not me.
Let's make sure there's any ground.
Okay.
Oh, you want some motor and gas, Leroy?
We can take out Birch Creek, all right. Don't need the motor and gas.
You mean on this trip?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of stuff do you want?
You talked to Fred, and I talked to a guy up here this morning. That came out yesterday.
Ready to go?
Okay.
Oh,
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi. Oh, sure.
Get your glasses on.
I don't want any glasses.
Yes, sir.
Cleopatra, going down her
path. We got them right away here.
Goodbye.
Be sure to ride.
The water is quite muddy due to the runoff of snow water in the high mountains. And of course, the river has quite a few fish in it, but we very seldom fish on the trip until we get down to the lake. This trip is made essentially in the spring when the water is high enough so we can run the river easily. As the progress is, the river drops very low and then it would be difficult to go down. Now in early spring, you usually have nice days and fairly cool nights, but on our trip down, we had very hot weather. This was extremely hot for the entire West. And on some days there, the thermometer was up over 100 right out in the bright sunshine. This increased the temperature of the water, so it made it just comfortable.
into that rock sunlight like that, okay? Yeah.
All of our boats are manned by professional guides. On this Hawaii trip, we'll have Dave Helfrich, my oldest son, Bill Pruitt, and Leroy Pruitt, and Pete Wingert. And our boys have many years of experience. We don't venture on these wild rivers except with experienced guides.
I'm Leroy Pruitt, and I've been guiding since 1945, started when I was in high school. And as I said, in 45, I took out my first license. And I've worked the various rivers around the state of Oregon and Idaho. I have four children. I'm married and have two boys and two girls of my own. And I stick with the guiding because it's a real good profession. It's clean, outdoors. I meet a lot of people, various types of people. And 99% of them, wonderful, great people. I like being my own boss.
There's many things of interest on a trip like this. There's wildflowers, birds, wild animals, Indian artifacts, Indian paintings, and last but not least, the terrific scenery of a beautiful canyon country like this. A great many people down this river. We make one, two, or three trips a year. We plan our parties well in advance so we can get experienced guides, and we make this trip, and it's certainly a trip for the adventurous.
one of the old geese in the...
Sneaking up through there. This nice big spring coming in over to the left is known as Horsehole Springs. This is one of the spots where we can get lovely, fresh, cold water. For the most part, well, we drink the river water because it's still pure, but we like our nice, clear water. This Owyhee country is very interesting to the geologist. It's essentially a volcanic area, but notice those huge, big cliffs of rhyolite, many different colors, and you notice that soft rhyolite rock is topped with a black lava. That black lava is very hard, and it protects the rhyolite from weathering. We'll see many different formations down through here, and some of them would actually be of park importance if people could get down in this country and see them. Getting in some big way now, boys. We'll have to ride them out. Here comes a big breaker. Here's a really a big one. Now we've got the rhythm of these waves. We can get them right through without one breaking. But if you don't catch that rhythm, why, you can look for a lap full of water most any time.
This is a very remote area of the Owyhee River trip. What do you know about this cabin here, Prince?
Well, Bob, I've been told the story about this old cabin from one of the old-timers here, Fred Scott, at Rome. And he told me that this was an old rustler's hideout in the early days, and he also told me that he helped clean them out in 1905.
I've never seen another cabin in Oregon that's built out of that adobe-type rock. Have you, Prince?
Well, this, no, I haven't. This is called rhyolite. This is a soft rock. And if you'll notice, they've sawed it. They've sawed these chunks out. Yeah.
And then over here you have a little storage shed that's covered by mud and brush.
That would be their cellar. See, they used to rustle cattle and bring them in here and hold them until they would get a fairly good-sized herd. Then they would crush them across the river in here and take them south to Winnemucca and sell them.
Is that so? There were also a lot of Indians in this country in those days, or a little earlier than that,
I guess. Yes, that's right. This was a great valley for the Paiute Indians.
Yeah.
The Paiute Indians, of course, are very widely distributed. Right down in front of the old rustler's cabin, there's a hot spring. This is almost too hot for bathing. You've got to go into it very slowly. We'll find these hot springs on many of the different eastern Oregon rivers, and at two or three of our camps on the Owyhee, we'll have a nice hot spring to bathe in. Well, we'll see avocet on this trip because they're migrating, and we'll occasionally see them on the beach. But there's many, many different kinds of birds here, some of them that you don't see in western Oregon, but we'll see them over here in eastern Oregon. And, of course, there's many different water birds that you'd only see along a river or along a lake shore. This is a great country to go through. If you notice, the last few miles, we've been in some beautiful formations of rhyolite capped with a black lava. This scenery in here in places is equal to Bryce Canyon or Zion National Park for scenery. And I'm sure there's been a very few people that have ever seen it. It's only been just a few of the people that have been running rivers come down through here that would ever see scenery like this. This is a volcanic area, and you see a great many of the volcanic formations. All the way down this river, distance of 60 miles, we'll see these different areas. and especially, we're especially interested in the Indian campgrounds and the old Indian artifacts that we might find. In the early days, this was a favorite place for the Indians to camp. If we search around there, we're apt to find old skinning knives, or pestles, mortars, Indian arrowheads, or anything like that. And in the rocks around these campgrounds, you'll always find petroglyphs. And in the Indian caves, well, you'll find the pictographs, or the pictures made by the red paint. We don't any more than get out of one rapid till we're into another one. We're looking for a place to camp this evening, and we have in mind a place called Whistling Bird. It's one of our nicest camps on the Owyhee, and we try to hit it on the second night of our trip down the river. Up to that point, we will have covered about 25 miles of the 50 or 60 mile trip through here. You might wonder why we call it Whistling Bird. It's one of the very few places here in Oregon that you can hear the canyon wren singing. You notice all these little birds flying around over the water now? These are the little cliff swallows or mud daubers. And we'll pass some of their nests tomorrow. Oh, boys, in the distance, I can see old Whistling Bird coming up. This is Whistling Bird Camp that I was telling you about. And this is one of the few rapids that we have to get out and look at. When we get there, well, we'll pull in and walk down and see where we're going to run it. At this stage of the water, I think we can go through all right. But a huge chunk of the mountainside has slid off and slid right into the river, and it leaves quite a channel. In fact, half of the river goes in back of this big slab. And I don't think it'd be possible to run back in there because it'd be just almost like going through a cave. But we'll pull in and size things up and see where we can go through, and we'll be able to go through someplace or other. We're starting down a big one here. This is Whistling Bird. This is one we've been talking about for a long time. Okay, we're lined up here for it. Oh, this is a rough one. What's that big hole? You coming, Billy? Oh, we're gonna make her. Here comes Billy. He's got her made. That's it. There's Whistling Bird made. Yes, that was a pretty tough pull right in there. We plan these meals out well in advance. The first night is usually steaks, and the second night, chicken. Notice tonight we're having chicken. Billy and Leroy are frying chicken.
That's a coil of you.
Well, I've been a long time.
Gotta go.
When we get to camp, each one of the guides has a special job to do. One guide will fry the steaks, one will make the salad, and one will make the cornbread or biscuits. Now, it's my job to make the cornbread and biscuits. We mix these up using our own river recipes, and we cook them in the old-fashioned Dutch oven.
We'll look out here.
We'll get some rum every day.
It'd be all right. I don't know where it is.
It's in a staple box, I think,
This oven is even better than your electric oven at home. You know, these women always like to come around and find out about our recipes.
What is the reason for the fewer coals in the center and more?
It gets hotter in the center.
How do you know whether it's down in the bottom?
Well,
maybe you ought to open that lid off.
Sometimes you have to peek a little bit. I usually take about one peek to see how things are coming along, and then the rest of it, well, you guess.
Yeah, Roy, you need some cannon.
Oh, a little bit wouldn't hurt, but we don't.
Get cornbread ready. Eric, you're up.
All right, take them.
Is it down there?
It's nice and brown.
If I didn't,
are you done?
Thank you.
Put that on your cornbread, Gene.
I don't want that on my cornbread, but I want it.
How's that for an answer?
Oh God, my mouth watered.
Did you get better
on the film? Oh no,
my mouth watered. That's what they tell me. Well, I'm Dave Helfrich. I make my living as a river guide. The Owyhee here is just one of the many rivers that I fish or make river trips on throughout the year. I fish the Mackenzie and live there. The Owyhee, the Middle Fork of the Salmon River in Idaho. I run summer camps for boys in the High Cascades. It's the month of August. In September and October, I work the rogue with my family. I also am a licensed guide in the state of Washington and spend about 2.5 months every year up there fishing for winter steelhead out of the little town of Forks. I'm a married man, 3 children, and all of them I hope are going to be guides someday.
Prince, where are the Indian caves we're going to go through?
Right back of you.
Well, there's Indian caves right back of the camp here. Where we're
going. Oh, are they? Tomorrow morning we'll go through them?
Yes, we'll go through them tomorrow. On one trip through, I can remember of counting 28 Indian caves. All showed signs of having been lived in, and with never a sign of a white man ever seeing the cave. You'd walk into a cave and maybe there'd be a skinning knife, an obsidian skinning knife on the floor, maybe there'd be an arrowhead. On one cave, I remember we found 6 paint stones that the Indians used to make their red paint out of to paint on the rocks. And so there's something for everyone, of some interest for everyone. The wildflowers, very unusual wildflowers over here, many of them that we haven't even identified yet. But there's the birds and the flowers and the animals and the Indian caves and the fun of riding the rapids, so everything put together makes a great trip. We can be able to roll right up to their nests and look in.
Look at the different stages of their nest in there. You tell me the distance you want. Here.
It's quite an unusual thing on these little swallows. Some years you don't find them on the Owyhee because of the lack of insects. Now, for some reason, they know that they've been here the previous year and have decimated the insects, so maybe they'll move to some other river. But this year is a great year for swallows on the river. Here's a nice little rapid, boys. River's up high enough now, it doesn't cause us much trouble, but if the river's low, why, we really have to watch this. You'll notice as you look ahead, you'll see these waves break, and to an experienced riverman, each one of these waves breaking means something. It means the rock under the water there, anywhere from a few inches to a few feet. The experienced man can pick those out, and that's probably the greatest secret in running bad water, is picking out the route to go. Now, see those waves breaking ahead of us? Now, we'll catch those just after they break, if we can. Well, there's one. There we are. We caught that one just as it broke and got out of it. Now, if we'd caught that a little bit sooner, why, it'd come right in the boat. That's the secret of riding big water. Of course, if you get into rough water, into rocky water, why, it's a much different technique. The river's high now, and we're having no trouble.
Bob and Dean are capsized.
Yeah, it's the only rock available. Try and get them before they get into that next rapid, if you can. I guess they'll be all right in that one.
Here comes Dave's boat. Pick them up.
Have you got your paddle, Bob? You got your paddle all right? Okay.
You can hang on to the boat. I'm pulling you to shore now. You can hang on to the boat.
Huh? All right.
Hang on.
You can get a hold of Mike. Can you get a hold of the boat?
You ready to get a hold of the boat?
Everything. You hit only rock up there in that one rapid. That's what got you there. Did you notice that? You went right over that rock. That one there, and it looked like a wave. It just nice and smooth on top, and he went over.
I should have known better.
Yeah.
You know, I was in trouble because these pants, I didn't have a belt on them, and they came off.
Oh, is that right?
And they got down around my ankles, so I couldn't
care. You have a really nice, quiet place like this. Why, look out, because it means some kind of a dam ahead. We've always recognize that on a river trip. When you have a nice quiet pool, why, it means that the river is blocked ahead, backing water up. So when we round this next turn, why, we've got to look ahead, because we'll have a real frog strangler. Okay, boys, here's a big one. Here's one we've been talking about for several days. This is Montgomery Rapids, one of our biggest ones of the whole canyon trip. There, Dave's through. He made it. And we're going to take a different place. Here we go. Clear sailing ahead. Oops. There, we got her made. Now, here comes one more through. Here comes Bub. Now, this is one of the toughest rapids that he faces. He's right so far, and he's headed for the chute. There he goes, right down between the rocks. Watch it. I believe he's going to make it. There he goes. He's almost got her made. Oh, that's great. A few more feet, whoop, right there. He's high centered right there. Bob made the whole thing, finally high centered on a rock. Big raft now. This is gonna be a tough one. Leroy Pruitt at the sweeps, everything is going good. He's got her all lined up. That channel's about 10 feet wide, and he's hitting it. He's coming right to the center of it. Oh, that's gonna be a great one. His passengers are hanging on. He's got it made. Here comes the last boat. This is Billy Pruitt with one passenger. Here comes Billy. Looks like he's going to take the passageway between the big rocks. Here he goes. He's poised, right ready for the chute. There he goes. He's on his way down. Nice job. Made her very nicely. That's all the boats through now. On our trip from Rome downstream to the Owyhee Reservoir, this is the deepest canyon that we'll go through. Just look in the distance, see those tremendous rock walls. This must be, at least 2,000 feet deep here in places. And one side or the other shuts in as a sheer rock wall all the time. Notice in these high rim rocks, notice all the different colors of lichen. There's green and gray and yellow, red. That's what makes the beauty of a canyon like this, is the lichen on the rocks and then the little tufts of grass and the little meadows between them. Well, one time we took an ornithologist down this river, and he said it was possible to pick up 90 birds on this river. That means to identify 90 different birds. He either saw them or heard their song on the trip.
First of my baby's life, last Saturday evening, I came to the old oak tree that stands beside the river where you were to meet me. On the ground of your glove I found with a note addressed to me. It read, dear love, I've done you wrong, now I must set you free. No longer could I bear this hurt and this sin. I just couldn't tell you that guy was just a friend. Moody River, more deadly than the plainest knife. Moody River, your muddy waters took my baby's life. Look into the muddy water and what could I see? I saw a lonely, lonely face just looking back at me. Tears in his eyes and prayer upon his lips, and the glove of his lost love at his fingertips. Moody River, more deadly than the faintest knife. Moody River, your muddy waters took my baby's life.
It doesn't take us long for a camp breakfast and load and get on our way. Each boy has his own job to do. One boy will make the hot cakes, one will fry the bacon, somebody will fry the eggs, somebody will mix up the fruit juice, and we're on our way. And each fella has his own job, knows what it is, and soon the boats are loaded and we're ready to float down the river.
Yeah.
If we wanted luxury, we'd go in Salem.
Getting along towards the end of the trip now, and notice how the scenery changes. We've been in these tremendous deep canyons. As we get down farther and farther, we're beginning to run out of them and into open grasslands more and more. However, we still have a few big forbidding cliffs hanging over us in places. But now we're getting into the area where the Indians used to camp and hunt and fish down in here. And during this period of time, which now is about 16 years that we've been making trips on the Owyhee, we've got to know it quite well.
Hey,
passenger is Prince Helfrich. Well done.
My name is Pete Wingert. I'm from Anaheim, California. Most people might wonder why in the world a person from California would be spending so much time on rivers of Oregon and the Northwest. But once you experience the beauty of these trips and the environment, it always makes me think of seeing these areas much as Lewis and Clark did, because these areas have been very little touched by civilization. And seeing them by boat disturbs them not in the least. So I've had the great pleasure of seeing quite a few of the rivers of the West now with the Helfriches, the Blackwater of Canada, the Middle Fork of Idaho, and the Rogue River of Oregon, and several other rivers here of Oregon. And I certainly hope to see quite a few more of them. Oregon has begun to fascinate me to the point where I definitely hope to make it my home.
All right, here's the biggest rapid of our trip. Here's Leroy in his big boat now, getting ready to come through. There's a little opening out in there about 10 feet wide. Leroy's lined up for it. There he's throwing his boat around. He lined up just perfect. Here he comes down through it. One more stroke and he's got it made. He made it perfectly. Nice work, Leroy. Leroy's through with the big boat.
Through.
He's lined up good. Now he's coming down the little chute. That's carrying him over, and he's hitting two or three hard strokes.
He's in the wrong channel.
Up, he got in the wrong channel, but he's gonna make it anyhow. He bumped the rock a little bit, but he's through. He made it fine. See, that's amazing that you don't have time to cut over in there, isn't it?
It's good.
Lining up.
Pull to the left and come around that like that. You'd be right in.
Pete's getting too far to the left.
He's right in the chute, but he doesn't know.
He's got it made.
Yeah, he lucked out.
Yeah, he got it made. He made the best job of anybody.
Now who's on top?
We'll put Pete on top.
Yeah, Pete's our number one man.
Yeah.
We go past one place where for a quarter of a mile up and down the stream, on almost all the rocks, there's petroglyphs. We don't know what they mean, but they're a lot of different figures. We found pictographs, which is their pictures made with their red paint on the rocks. And in other places, we found petroglyphs, which is chiseling right into the rock. We keep our food on the ice. And so therefore at lunchtime, we can have fresh meats, we can have cottage cheese, an ice cold drink, anything that's necessary for keeping on ice. We've been in pretty rough water the last two or three days, but when we reach this nice quiet water down here with just a few rapids, you can get out your air mattresses and float down. It's a lot of fun. Get an air mattress out on the river and with your bathing suit on, crawl up on it and ride it through some of these smaller rapids. In fact, some of our fellows are capable of riding them through some very rough rapids. It's amazing. You can take them through almost like you can take a boat. And it's really a great ride.
I'm Bill Pruitt from Grants Pass, Oregon. I've been guiding part-time since 1952. Started boating in 1950. And been in business and part-time guiding until 3 years ago when I switched to full-time guiding to include river boating and packing, hunting and fishing. I run a mountain climbing school and run trail hikes and so on like that. And we like the guiding business because it's outdoor work and it's very interesting. It's always changing from 1 hour to the next, and every day and every week is changing.
There's a man who really likes cauliflower.
Well, I do, and no fool.
Turn the river, Ron.
That damn wind got me going round and round this thing.
Miserable wind, isn't it?
What a pill. See, we are coming.
When you skin them,
can you imagine yourself eating
them? They're flesh and mm-hmm. real nice. When you skin them and you eviscerate them, we cut them up in sections and soak them in salt water overnight. And then in the morning, while we salt them, roll them with flour, brown butter, you know, what's the time between kind of like a good tough chicken to me.
We've seen quite a number of herds of wild horses along the Owyhee at various times. And in the lower Owyhee, a place they call the Owyhee Breaks, is probably the last remaining large herd of wild horses in Oregon. This country is very interesting from a standpoint of how it's managed. The Bureau of Land Management takes care of all of this through here, and it's Taylor grazing area. Each area is allotted to some rancher, either to a cattleman or to a sheepman. And the water holes are improved. Water is pumped in certain places. The pasture, the grass is watched very carefully so it isn't overgrazed, and it's really managed in a very nice shape. In the early days, of course, you know, the cattlemen and the sheepmen in this country had some tremendous range wars. We found some very interesting old cabins along the river where some of them have been put in there by the early day trappers, some of them by the early day rustlers, and some of them by more recent cattlemen. I remember a message that a man left there in 1890. He said, "A grizzly bear has killed my horse. I've got to walk out of here." And another message was in 1895, this man said, "The coldest day in history." He said, "I crossed the river on the ice today with my horses." At our takeout, the work begins. We've got to load all of these boats. We have four Mackenzie boats, and we deck them one inside of the other on a very sturdy trailer. Then we have our big rubber boat, and we must deflate that and then roll it up into a small bundle, but the bundle is still very heavy, and then roll it into the back of a pickup. And we take our big sweeps, fold them up. We have all of our baggage to pack into the jeeps, our food boxes, our bedrolls, our tents, and everything like that. It's quite a little job getting everything in ship shape in order to drive over the rough roads going out of here.
It'll be my big boat.
Get started up. Somebody's gas.
You put it in up there first.
Now forward, Pete. Get the back end down. Just like in front of him. That's
Maybe we can level it once we get a ship.
Down, little
fella. Better drop it down.
Okay, lift.
Yeah, that's good. Now let's turn that side over to this side. Tip her right upside down. Okay, let her come. All the way, let her come.
Stop.
Yeah.
This canyon that we're going up is called Birch Creek, and it's a very, very scenic canyon putting into the Owyhee. As we go up it, it's a test for almost any car, although we have several four-wheel drive Jeeps with us, so it's a test for those that don't have four-wheel drive. We're winding back and forth, zigzagging, until finally we'll get up to the top of the plains. There's quite a number of lakes called Cow Lakes. There's very few people know about this area because it's such a remote place in Oregon. These lakes are stocked with fish, it's good fishing, and nearby, notice those volcanic cones, which would say, speaking from geological time, they're within 400 or 500 years. And then down below us is the Owyhee Reservoir. We've traveled by river almost to the upper end of the Owyhee Reservoir. Now, if we'd continue on down, we'd have 50 miles of lake water until we'd come to the Owyhee Dam. This is Prince Helfrich telling you the story of the Owyhee. We hope you've enjoyed the trip, and next year we'll have other rivers to run. There's several nice trips that we've planned, and we hope to have you on some of those and show you some more pictures of Oregon's wild rivers.